Leah here from leahforsci.com, and in this video, we'll begin our discussion of oxidation and reduction reactions of organic compounds, as you'll see in organic chemistry. Think back to when you first learned about redox in general chemistry. You've probably seen one of these mnemonics, oil rig, which stands for oxidation is loss, reduction is gain. I don't like this because it doesn't tell me what I'm gaining and losing, and if a mnemonic doesn't tell me what it is, I get confused. The second mnemonic I learned from a student, and I find that much more applicable. Leo the lion says, grrr. And this mnemonic tells me that the loss of electrons is an oxidation reaction, and the gain of electrons is a reduction reaction. And this worked very well in general chemistry when you look at batteries and circuits and electrons moving on a wire. But in organic chemistry, you're looking at bonds being formed, atoms moving from one molecule to the other. How can we apply this? Let's take a step back and reevaluate what we know about oxidation and reduction. Oxidation is the loss of electrons. And if you think of an electron dragging a proton with it, we have a hydrogen atom. So oxidation is really the loss of a hydrogen atom. Reduction is the gain of electrons. And if we take the electron and bring a proton with it, we simply have the gain of a hydrogen atom. But redox in organic chemistry often involves the oxygen atom. So think of oxygen and hydrogen as antagonistic to each other. If we take an atom that has hydrogen and put an oxygen on it, we separated the carbon to hydrogen bond. So in losing that hydrogen atom, we gained an oxygen atom. So oxidation has oxygen in it. It can be the loss of a hydrogen atom or the gain of an oxygen atom. I'll often write oxygen as OX instead of just O, so we don't confuse it with a letter or a zero. Reduction, which is the gain of a hydrogen atom, can also be the loss of an oxygen atom. But there's one more method you're used to recognizing for oxidation and reduction, and that is the oxidation number or the change in oxidation number. For example, if I have the ion Fe2+, reacting to form Fe3+. You've probably learned that when the oxidation number goes up, that is oxidation. How do you know this? I think of it as the oxidation number having gone up, up with an O. When the charge goes up, it's an oxidation. On the other hand, the reverse reaction here has the oxidation number going down or being reduced. And the word reduced has reduction in it. So that's a third way to look at it. Oxidation is when we go up in charge, and reduction is when we reduce the charge. We'll use a combination of these three approaches when looking at the oxidation and reduction reactions of organic compounds. I'll go through a couple of them in this video to give you an overview, but I'll cover them in much more detail in the remainder of this series, including step-by-step explanations and detailed mechanisms. You can find this entire series along with the redox practice quiz and cheat sheet by visiting my website leahforsci.com/redox. Let's start with a simple reaction. An alkene can be both oxidized and reduced. If we take this molecule and do hydration, for example, reacting it with H2SO4 in the presence of H2O. You should recognize this as the acid-catalyzed hydration of alkenes, which will break the pi bond and give me an alcohol on the more substituted carbon. In this case, it doesn't matter because they're both equivalent, so I get an OH. We recognize this as an oxidation reaction because we gained a bond to oxygen. The carbon here got oxidized, but now let's prove it looking at the oxidation number. In general chemistry, you learn to take all the atoms, add up their oxidation numbers, and that should equal to the charge of the molecule, which is fine when you're dealing with small ions, but when you have large organic molecules, it gets overwhelming. Instead, we want to zero in on just the atom in question and see what happens to that atom. For carbon in particular, if it's bound to another carbon, they're equal. The charge is zero. If it's bound to a hydrogen atom, as we have here, well, think of the hydrogen as having an oxidation number of +1. If the molecule is net neutral and carbon is bound to an oxidation of +1, It has to be minus one. That's what gives us the neutrality. So we're starting with a negative one carbon. And for the product, don't forget we still have that hydrogen atom. Hydrogen is still plus one. Oxygen is more electronegative. It's minus one. Plus one and minus one equals zero. So the carbon holding them is also zero to give us a net neutral. What happened to the oxidation state of carbon? It went from negative one up to zero. Zero is greater than negative one. And since it went up in oxidation state or up in charge, we know it's an oxidation. The alcohol can be oxidized further. We can get a ketone, we can get an aldehyde if it's terminal, we can cleave the molecule, oxidative cleavage, to give me aldehydes or carboxylic acids. Well, let's hold off on that for now. Another reaction that I can do here is to react the alkene in the presence of something like H2 with a palladium carbide catalyst. You should recognize this as the alkene reduction reaction. In addition to the two hydrogens initially on the carbon, we now have two more hydrogen atoms from this reaction, so that carbon is fully saturated. We recognize this as reduction because reduction is the gain of electrons with protons, meaning the gain of a hydrogen atom, but let's take a look at the oxidation number as well. Each hydrogen atom has an oxidation of plus one. What will balance plus two? Minus two. So carbon here has an oxidation number of minus two and minus two. Both carbon atoms reacted. What is the process of going from negative one to negative two? We had to reduce the charge by one. We dropped it, negative one down to negative two. And because it's reduced by one, this is a reduction reaction. As you're studying this in class, don't go through all these oxidation numbers. I'm simply showing it to you to prove it to you, but I want you to use the trick of gain hydrogen atoms, reduction, gain oxygen atoms, oxidation. Let's take a look at an alkyne, which is the same general structure, but there's a triple bond between the two carbon atoms instead of just a double bond. We can still carry out a series of hydration reactions. For example, if we react it with HgSO4 in H2SO4, you should recognize this as the oxymercuration of an alkyne, which will first give you an enol that'll tautomerize to give you a ketone. What type of reaction is this? Well, we had zero bonds to oxygen in the beginning. We gained two bonds to oxygen. It has to be an oxidation reaction, which she shows an oxygen in brackets. But let's prove it by looking at the oxidation state of the carbon that changed. This carbon is only bound to carbon. That means it's neutral in its oxidation number. It's zero. Since carbon that's double bound to oxygen is double bound to a more electronegative atom, we get a negative, not per oxygen, but per oxygen bonds. So this bond here is negative one. This bond is negative one. That means the carbon to balance it must be positive two. From neutral, zero, all the way up with an O. If it goes up by two, it's an oxidation reaction. How do we know? We gain bonds to oxygen. The alkyne can be oxidized in many different ways. We can get a diol, we can get a diketone, we can get an aldehyde if it's terminal, cleave it to get carboxylic acids and more, but the concept is the same. Gaining bonds to oxygen is oxidation. If we reduce the alkyne, we can get a mix of an alkane, a cisalkene, or even a transalkene. The central carbons, the carbons that start out triple bond, have no hydrogens. And I want you to notice that each of these products has more hydrogen atoms than what we had initially. We won't go through the individual oxidation numbers because by now, I hope you see the pattern and understand gaining those hydrogen atoms is a reduction reaction. And we'll go into it in more detail for the redox of alkenes and alkynes video. Another common redox series you'll see starts or ends with an alcohol. If we start with a primary alcohol, we can partially oxidize it to get an aldehyde. How do we know it's oxidation? Carbon has one bond to oxygen. Here it has two bonds to oxygen. But look at what else happened. We have two hydrogen atoms here. We only have one hydrogen atom here. So in addition to gaining a bond to oxygen, we also lost a bond to hydrogen. Both of these are definitions for oxidation. We can oxidize this even further to a carboxylic acid. So primary alcohol can form an aldehyde or a carboxylic acid. And notice the carboxyl group has an additional bond to oxygen on the carbon atom. If we take the same sequence and reverse it, we lose one bond to oxygen for a single reduction. We lose another bond to oxygen for another reduction all the way back to a primary alcohol. If we start with a secondary alcohol, we can only do one simple oxidation before we start breaking the carbon chain. How do you know we can only do one oxidation? We only have one hydrogen atom on carbon to remove. In order to oxidize, we need to remove hydrogen and add oxygen. Getting that second bond to oxygen gives carbon four bonds to either carbon or oxygen, and that's as far as it can go unless we go to extreme conditions and turn it into something like an ester. This is the oxidation, and if we reverse it by removing the bond to oxygen, adding a hydrogen, that would be a reduction. A secondary alcohol is oxidized to a ketone, and that's it. Now what happens if I want to oxidize a tertiary alcohol? The answer is I can't. In order to oxidize, I have to remove hydrogen. Carbon doesn't have any. I have to gain a bond to oxygen. Well, how? If carbon already has four bonds, and I try to add a fifth bond by creating that double bond, we've just violated carbon's octet. It has five bonds when the max is four, and that can't happen. So you cannot oxidize a tertiary alcohol. If you see this on the exam, just write N/R for no reaction. The trickiest aspect of redox, in my opinion, are all the reagents. Every time you learn a reaction, you learn 1, 2, 3, 4, and it can get very, very overwhelming. I don't want you to focus on which reagent does what. Instead, I want you to understand why and how they do it. Let's look at some of the common oxidation reagents you're going to see. KMnO4, CrO3, O3, any form of Cr2O72-, in this case we have Na2 or K2 to balance it. And now let's look at reduction. Common ones you'll see are LaH, which is lithium aluminum hydride, NaBH4, sodium borohydride, and more. Look at what we see in the reagents. If oxidation is gaining bonds to oxygen, should we not use a reagent that is absolutely overflowing with oxygen atoms, so overflowing that it's available to donate it to the molecule? And if the reduction is loss of oxygen or gain of hydrogen, should we not use a reagent that is packed with hydrogen atoms? And that is what you're looking for. So if you're trying to figure out if it's oxidation or reduction, ask yourself, what atom do I see in my reagent and how can that possibly influence my product? Be sure to join me in upcoming videos where we break down the reagents, break down the mechanisms, and show you what happens with every specific type of oxidation and reduction for all the common ones you'll see in organic chemistry. You can find the entire series along with my redox practice quiz and cheat sheet by visiting my website, leahforsci.com/redox.